Karolis Petrauskas and I'm presenting the paper by Shard, Sharding in a Byzantine environment. And in this paper, the topology in question is presented here, and we have Byzantine setting, so nodes can crash, they can recover, they can lie. And in this paper, the setup is split into kind of shards, and each shard should maintain own state instead of the usual setup in Byzantine setting when you replicate data through all the nodes in the same way. So the sharding is the main question here. And the main ideas in this paper is that, okay, if talking about sharding, then Byzantine setting is the interesting point here. In this paper, a family of sharding algorithms are presented. There are 18 of them. They made by combining different components in the algorithm. And the paper presents the orchestrate execute model, and it allows to have pluggable orchestration part and as well the pluggable locking part, which ensures the consistency modes. What was maybe not specified very well, this paper mentions the cluster sending communication abstraction that provides no algorithm for used for it. So I will provide the communication abstraction definition, but not the algorithm. It considers all those shards as black boxes, and they run some Byzantine consensus algorithm, and it is not that important which algorithm they run actually. The point here is that you should minimize those intercluster communications as well as consensus rounds in this setup. The motivation of the paper is around the blockchains, but it is not really clear if those blockchains, only permission blockchains are considered, or permissionless ones considered as well. So the mentioned cluster sending protocol, so one cluster running Byzantine consensus algorithm inside it can send a value to other shard composed of a cluster of Byzantine nodes and running a Byzantine consensus algorithm. And the properties are the following of that assumed communication abstraction is that the shard can only send a message to another shard if consensus is reached on sending that value. And on the receiving side, the faulty, non-faulty replicas will receive that value that was sent. And on the sending side, the sending shard will obtain confirmation of that recite. And those shards here always are clusters of several nodes running some Byzantine algorithm, consensus algorithm. The orchestrate execute model is defined here, and it allows to run the multi-shard transactions. There is no problem with single shard transactions because everything then taken by the Byzantine consensus algorithm inside that shard, and all the paper talks about inter-shard or multi-shard transactions. All the execution is modeled in so-called shard steps, and each shard step can inspect local data in that shard, then modify the data and forward the execution to another shard using the cluster sending abstraction we considered before. Yeah, and to have some more structure in that execution, the shard steps are grouped in several categories. So those can be either void steps. In the void step, a shard can check conditions of the transaction, can update local data and acquire logs. In commit step, it can modify data and release logs only. And the abort step can modify data to roll back some values and also release logs. Even from these names, it is visible that the entire algorithm is built around two-phase commit. Which will be apparent next. Yeah, so the orchestration part. Orchestration step in this orchestration execution model is used to replicate the data to all the involved shards. And the paper presents three different ways to implement that. So the first one is linear approach. So the client sends the transaction to the first involved shard. It checks preconditions for the objects the shard is responsible for. And then if preconditions are met, execution of a step is successful, it forwards the transaction to the next shard in the transaction, and that continues until the last shard last involved shard is reached, and then that shard sends either commit or abort message to all the shards in the cluster. The advantage of this approach in executing a transaction is that you can have early abort. If the first node detects unmet conditions, then the transaction can be rejected without involving other shards at all. And as we will see later, this approach allows to have a particular order for traversing those shards, and that helps with avoiding deadlocks. The next approach is a centralized, and it looks exactly like two-phase commit. The root shard is selected for each transaction independently, so kind of hash of transaction data or something. So different transactions can have different root shards. It sends the transaction to all the involved shards in parallel. They check their preconditions, execute the transaction shard step, and sends the results to the centralized, to the root shard back. So like a coordinator of in the two-phase commit. And then when the coordinator collects all the answers, it sends the decision to all the shards in the cluster. Each arrow in this chart represents the cluster sending step, the abstraction that was described before in the slides. And each point in this chart, like here or here, involves a consensus step inside this shard. So this computation is quite heavy, and in this case it always includes four steps. Yeah, so in typical case, each cluster receives a message and executes consensus on receiving that message from other consensus from other shard. But in this case, the optimization is involved when the root shard receives an event from the worker shards, so to say. It waits for all the messages to be received and only then executes a consensus step. In this way, it makes it much lighter. And the last option for the orchestration is the distributed orchestration. And it is executed, first part is executed similarly to the centralized orchestration, like two-phase commit. The root shard is selected based on transaction. It sends in parallel the message to all the involved shards, and then all the involved shards broadcast their decision not to the root shard, but to all the shards in the cluster. This way, each shard can detect the final decision independently when all the messages are received from all the involved shards, and then execute the consensus step and send the response back to the client. In this case, we have three steps instead of four steps as in centralized execution, but we have more cluster sending steps in this case. So that was about the orchestration. It was responsible for making the transaction atomic, either all nodes execute it or all nodes reject it. The execution part considers the isolation properties, because each shard executes the consensus locally inside the shard. And if we have multi-shard transaction, it can happen that other transaction will read partially committed data from one or other shard. So the execution part considers this, and it basically considers the two-phase locking in this scheme. So that. Yeah, and actually the execution part or isolation properties make the rules for destructing the transaction to shard steps. And we will see that they can be derived in different ways. The first approach here is to not use locking at all, and that is called isolation-free execution. So no isolation guarantees are presented in this case, and it works like this. If we have some transaction and we split it in such way that if a shard has condition on its objects in that transaction, then it performs update in the commit step, so prepare to commit, and abort steps are generated for such modifications in the case of abort. And if such step has no conditions at all, then the actual update is performed in the commit step. If conditions exist, so the vote step is used for actual updates. Yeah, so this approach gives us a minimal amount of execution steps, and I recall that each execution step is a consensus step in a Byzantine setting in that shard, so that's quite a heavy operation. But downside is that dirty reads are possible in this case. For the log-based execution, the same scheme is used, but read-write logs are introduced into this. To avoid deadlocks in the distributed log, a fixed ordering is assumed here, and it is derived by numbering the shards by some fixed order, and then ordering all the data items inside a shard. In this case, we can order all the data items in the cluster and organize the shard steps in such a way that we will take all the logs in a uniform order all the time. As a consequence of that, only a linear orchestration can be used in this, because then we can have order by shards, because centralized and distributed orchestration, the cluster steps are sent in parallel and the ordering is not satisfied, but yeah, in the linear orchestration it is. But in the paper they propose that non-blocking logs can be used as well, and they just, instead of waiting for log to be freed, they just fail, and I guess the client should think what to do with the transaction next. And then you don't need any ordering constraints, and you can use all the orchestration methods here. In this paper, using the logs, several serialization modes are defined. So for read uncommitted, only write logs are used. And to implement the read committed, read logs are used, but they are released immediately after reading a value. So they interfere with the write logs, but read logs don't restrict other writes. And for the serializable execution, read and write logs are used in a usual way. When you read a data, you acquire read log, and when you write data, you acquire the write log. The table above lists all the meaningful combinations, and those are those 18 algorithms presented in this paper. And HL is an algorithm they use as a reference for their evaluation. So they mentioned that AHL is kind of similar to one of their variant of the algorithm, and another algorithm with distributed serializable non-blocking clocks is similar to chain space algorithm. In this algorithm, in this evaluation, the consensus steps were abstracted away. So I guess real consensus was not executed, and that was kind of simulation of the algorithm. And for the experiments, they used 500 transactions for the workload. And each transaction by default uses affects or references 16 accounts, and 8 accounts have constraints defined on them. And by default, they use 64 shards and 8,000 accounts. So next, the paper presents three experiments made. So the scalability, contention, and factor scalability. Scalability is they keep the workload the same and increase the number of shards. So number of accounts per shard actually decreases when you increase the number of shards. Another case is for contention, number of active accounts per shard is increased. So the transaction would involve and the factor scalability experiment, a number of accounts is increased proportionally to the number of shards in this case. And they measured the basic metrics of that, the total execution time for all the workload to be processed, cumulative duration for processing the transactions, the throughput, and throughput for only the committed transactions, and as well the median shard step count. So depending on the workload, how many shard steps have to be generated in order to process a transaction in this model. Yeah, so those are results, but maybe we can leave them for the discussion. And basically, that's it from this paper. In general, they propose to use Byzantine shards as a black boxes that hide all the Byzantine stuff inside, and also use the cluster sending step, which hides Byzantine setting as well. So in general, all the algorithms presented here kind of formulated for the setting with even no crash failures. So yeah, that's interesting. The paper is about the Byzantine setting, but algorithm don't even consider the crashes. That's because the shards are clusters themselves, and they considered reliable in this case. That's it from me.